So I'm going to call, I'm not going to waste the time, I'm going to call Dana. And she will tell you a brief outdoor study. Okay, good evening, everyone. Thank you all so much for coming, my God. We planned this in so short notice. I think it's all of this came together within 2 weeks. But we planned it, we have been talking about it for a while. And every time we talk, every time something happens in the community, we say we are going to have a conversation with the children. Every time something happens, a death happens, somebody commits suicide, or something bizarre happens in the community, we say we are going to have a conversation. But it's a long time coming. So we do not want any more deaths, any more suicide. And we want to get to the point where we are going to listen to what the children have to say. We are going to learn how to listen and act, and we are hoping that they would learn to tell us and listen to us too. We are going to ask the experts here to tell us what we are doing wrong. We ask everybody to write their questions, their concerns, things that you think is going wrong or because of our culture and belief we are imposing on our children. So I call Dr. Cecile, I say, Dr. Cecile, we need to have this conversation. I know you are also in mental health, and I also know you are a pastor. But I think it's a conversation that we should have, and we should include everyone. We should include the children, we should include the parents, we should include the teachers, we should include the caregivers, everybody, the grandmothers. My mother is here, all the grandmas are here. I think we all would learn something. What is the problem? And the most, the, all of the time, what I heard is African parents do not listen. But then I said to them, well, you guys don't listen to us either. You don't listen to your teachers. You don't listen to each other. So how can you say African parents do not listen? So we decided that we're going to use that as our thing. Are we listening? And as you see, the t-shirt has multiple people. It has parents and parents, parents and children, children and children, a boy and a girl. And it was deliberate because we want everybody to say, well, I am going to be part of the listening process. So it's not just me listening. It's not just you listening. We all have to listen. We all have to listen to each other.
Are we listening? This article will attempt to present a conversation that every parent of a preteen and teenager should be cognizant of and identify some mistakes often made by parents. Hopefully, the panelists of subject matters expertise will also discuss parenting strategies that are safe, effective, and produce the desired results for teenagers as well as their parents. Before we delve into the discussion, let me define parenting in the four types of parenting styles. So parenting is simply the activity of bringing up a child. It involves loving, nurturing, providing, setting boundaries, setting examples, looking after, taking care, guiding, protecting, and encouraging, answering questions, giving directions, communicating clearly, and etc. So the four types of parenting is authoritarian or disciplinarian, permissive or indulgent, uninvolved, and authoritative, being overprotective and insisting on what career choice or what subjects to take in school, and that is often the beginning of conflict, miscommunication, or poor communication between parents and or their teenagers. When these conflicts begin to occur, teenagers begin to talk to their peers or to their parents of their peers, where they get the comfort that someone is listening to them.
The best for our children, there is no question. Every parent wants the best for their children in the general effort of trying to guide their children so they're successful at what the parents want. They often make parenting mistakes without even realizing that they're making these mistakes. It often takes a professional like a therapist, friend, or family member with. Not listening to our teenagers often leads to sub-parenting mistakes, which includes but not listening to the following, only concern about safety and looking for
successful parenting. While we are asking parents to listen to their teenagers, teenagers should also listen to their parents and make efforts to have an unequivocal communication. Teenagers often conclude that their parents are ignorant to their culture or parents do not understand what they say. Well, when someone does not understand what you say, you must explain what it is that you're trying to say. So the onus is on teenagers to explain what they mean. Teenagers must understand that their parents were once teenagers and they have more life experience to share with them if they can only listen as well.
We have to listen. We're here. We are experts. They're going to help us to know and to learn. And what we learn, we're going to take it with us and pass it to our friends, pass it to our neighbors, pass it to people so that we can have better children, better productive citizens.
Some lady that I called and said, Amanda, we're trying to do a couple of things here for the kids because we want our kids to start listening to us and we want, especially the parents, to listen to the kids.
If we have someone to talk to, it can be able to help us to build our communication skills. It can help us to build a career in the future. If we want to take a career, we need the advice of our parents or someone that has been on that path to direct us to know the right way we need to go. And also, it encourages us to live a healthy life. If we are confident enough to talk to our parents, we'll be bold to stand and talk to other people in public. If our friends are doing the wrong thing, we'll be bold enough to tell them, like, you know this is wrong, we can correct them in school. Or we can better stay away from them if we know they're doing the wrong thing.
I'm here for my Laurel Financial Tax Services, and I'm going to talk on behalf of my wife, also Cass Creation. She couldn't make it. Try to turn your body all one color. We do no bleaching. No bleaching whatsoever. Not really. It's all natural. And so basically, let me talk about my service. I do payroll and taxes. I'm going to count my trade. So guys, what I'm going to say, the taxes is going to be part of your life. It's going to be part of it. Money is going to be part of it. You got to respect money. You got to respect money. So I'm going to start with the parents. Because what we do, our kids will copy. Most of us, let's say the middle class, will buy stuff. Stuff means we collect stuff. The rich people buy stuff, things that can make them money. The tax laws were written for the rich people. But no, we can do the same thing. We can act like rich people. We can change our ways. But be true to yourself. Do the best you can do. You have. I'll tell you again. God didn't put you on this earth for just to stay around. You're here for a purpose. Find your purpose and make the best out of it.
Praise God. I'm glad to be here. Oh, it's my phone. I'm glad to be here. And I just want to, I'm here just to be a blessing and a support to the people. My daughter, she's 17 years old. She's back there. And one of the very first thing that I would say to young people as you grow, as you go into college, is grow to have a relationship with God for yourself. It's absolutely important. I grew up in a single parent home. My mother was an immigrant from Sierra Leone, and when she brought me to America when I was 10 years old, and I grew up in Pennsylvania. I think like my uncle was just saying, he went to a small school around that side to Ohio, Pennsylvania, is where I went to school. It's called Indiana University of Pennsylvania. And I was 16 years old when I started college at IUP, and it was challenging because there were so much things that in my home I didn't know was out there. But I left, and I was 6 hours away from home, driving every Thanksgiving, Christmas to go to school and come back home. And there were so many things that we were into, we were doing, we were living, that I was not prepared for in my Sierra Leone type of home when I went out there. So I want to encourage you, now that you have these opportunities, you're a lot of younger faces who are not yet in college yet, take advantage of what the aunties and uncles around you are teaching you, even from our mistakes. Because when you try to go out there and you step out on your own in that world, there are things that you're going to wish you were prepared for. There are things that I ran into that I wish I was prepared for, and I wasn't. So I got into some trouble. I, you know, as they would say, we are both, we built a couple of times. But I woke up really, really fast. Learn everything. every little bit that you can learn now and know from a very young age that you have a purpose. God has a plan for you and has an agenda for your specific life. Don't go and try to keep up with the Joneses and mingle with what everybody else is doing, because it's very important as early as you can to find your own specific identity and then do everything you can to make sure that nobody takes you off of the route that you know is specifically for you. And once you can do that, you'll be a success in anything you can do. So God bless you.
For this one here, I'm really proud. Laurel is a go-getter, and we really appreciate all this effort she's doing, trying to bring us also here to do something here. So this is very important. I just want to make a quick story just to reach out to the teenager also since I'm here. I am a grandmother now, and my daughter was in school, Morgan State, 3 years. She came out, I don't know, just have a little time out before she got pregnant. And what can you do? We all have a path in life. We wanted to go to college, have, you know, a step. We have a system. But sometimes that gets turned to another detour. But it's all good. The baby's the love of my life now. We're moving on. She'll go back and finish. So sometimes don't be discouraged what this teenager do. They're going to go another path. But you're going to kind of walk them back.
Oh, let me just bring that in this position. I mean, where we have this cabin under the compass of Almighty Allah, our Lord, for constant protection. And it's going to be our hope that what we've said today is going to continue. With that, let me thank you very sincerely for indulging my self-worship in vanity. Thank you.
Our presence here is a miracle, I would say, because we came here to indulge and make you guys know that whatever is happening, we're going to be listening as parents and as individuals in the community. We're going to listen and we're going to take more impact and put more things to make things happen. Children, we are here to listen to make things happen. That's why we have community, we have different organizations in the community. We can reach out to any communities and we can make sure that whatever you say to us, we can put it in practice.
We are listening. If you think we are not listening, we will start from today to listen to you guys.
Yes.
But you guys are people, okay? It's not only Trump. I want Trump to come out of you. I want Trump to come out of you, okay? I want everybody. I want to see you there tomorrow. Say, oh, Auntie UK, come on. Let me hire you, okay? I want you to become something. And I want you to know that we love you all, okay? We do love you.
And mental retaliation. Where I came from, the time I was in Sierra Leone, we have mental retaliation and nothing about mental health. Thank God it is beginning to progress gradually. And because of that, people who have psychological effects and some imbalances, because mental retardation is what exists, they end up making their situation get worse. Because they will take them up to where we used to call Christian, and they will inject them with Lagatin to quiet them. Instead of that dialogue, that therapeutic measures to provide. So when the discussion, the panel starts, I'll be focusing on that angle. And the concept of things believing that we don't hear from them. I had a little note that I titled "The Cry of the African Baby." Because most of the problem today, the African child thinks that the parents don't listen to them. And likewise, the parents being raised up in that African mindset. Now, so you for one. And then, God in between the line, but we're going to look at something between the dotted lines, the thin line, and the thick line in our parenting skills. I'm Dr. Abdulkese, the General Overseer of KBCI Ministries. I want to apologize. You know, I'm just texting my HVAC guy that they put the whole stuff, but it is not producing as it is. But we had to make this place available because of community out. community. Let's come together and talk to the parents and the team, because this team, it's seven years ago, it affected a member in our church coming all the way from Virginia. The son killed his dad. That boy is still in prison in Virginia.
My name is Alima Mustafa Palmer, and I intentionally leave the daughter out because I'm here as a community activist. I want us to be comfortable. I want us to be to dialogue. I am excited about this meeting. I have been doing this, I would say, for over 20, 25 years. It's time for our community to come together, and it's time for us to begin to develop constructive relationships. And one area is with the family. If we don't have our families, then we are not a boy. The family stands. The family is next to God. So therefore, we need to do what we need to do to develop our families. Most of you know me as Auntie Alima because of what I do in the community. I don't want to engage in a lot of, I don't want to make a speech. I want us to engage. I want us to have dialogues. Two things I want to do today. I want to talk about cultural dynamics. I think the bigger problem for us has to do with culture. And when I say culture, it doesn't mean just being African. Okay? It's the way we are brought up. Respecting this society, respecting our children. Our children also have to understand that they have to be responsible citizens. They can help us. You know, like I said, I don't want to make a speech, but I am proud to say I have a wonderful relationship with my children. And the reason for that is because I made myself available. Yes. We can talk from now till next week, but if we don't start, we're not going to get there. So today, I want us to begin to put things in place. Thank you. God bless.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Oh my God. Sounds like you guys are very tired. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Okay, that's a little bit better. So my name is Theodosia Edwards. I'm here as some different guests. I'm a parent of a preteen who's only 2 months away from being a teenager. And that's part of the reason why she's not here today. I said, Zara Gracie, get dressed, let's go. Mommy, I'm not going. I'm staying home with my mom. So I would like to listen from some of the experts. I don't think anyone up here can say you are an expert on children because our children are different, right? You can say you can come to the table and have conversations based on your experiences and share those experiences, but there's no expert on raising children. We're all learning as we go along. I am a school leader, a Baltimore City school leader. I've been in education for the past 15 years, from Pennsylvania through Maryland.
Really quickly, I come to you all not only as a health educator, but as one of you. I've been there and done that. So hopefully I can bring a more realistic point of view. So yes, feel free to ask any questions, and if you don't get to it today, please get in contact with me and get my contact information as well.
I'm here without all my credentials as a parent. I'm a mother of six, with a teenager at the university right now, a 14-year-old. The reason why, just like the initial say, teenager. First of all, I came with a different vehicle because they took the vehicle and then not at home. So, I think I can say a lot about teenagers and kids. I have from teenagers to 3-year-old. I hope we can digest what we're going to talk about today from those that know about kids and the kids, what you guys know and afraid to talk about, so we all can learn and learn from each other and know how we can incorporate that in our daily lives.
Hello, good evening. My name is Arsenia decisions. Born in America, never raised until he even came back to America at a young age. So I can relate to you. I can relate to growing up at a home with a single parent. So whatever questions you may have, I believe I can help answer that. But also, I'm here to talk about how to be African and to embrace it and to be proud of who you are. You can be American, but yet still respect and appreciate being an African. Thank you.
My name is Ibrahim Mashiq Kamara Jr., commonly known as DK. I'm here, been here, done that, give you my insight, my experience. I came to the state when I was 10. I got a scholarship to go to Syracuse. I didn't want to go out of town. I want to stay home. My mom forced me, so you got to leave this area. You can't be here. You got to go. I wasn't mentally ready. I listened to my mom. I went there. First year, I told her, I don't like it over there. I want to go back. She said, no, you're going to stay there. My second year, I said, no, I'm not going back. So came back, transferred, went to Howard. My junior year, I got somebody pregnant. And that was the reason my mom didn't want to stay there. So I had to drop out of school for 2 years to take care of my daughter. Right now, my daughter, she just graduated from an Hampton University. And I'm here to give you my experience, what I've been through as well. I'm currently, I graduated at Howard Computer Science. I'm an IT specialist with the Department of Defense.
My name is Sal Denver, and some of you guys know me on social media, the Madina Power. But like my other colleagues said, being in Denver, I came here in 1990, and I was 10. And I just want you guys to be very open, asking questions in your views, in my views, especially when it comes to our parents understanding where we're coming from. Peer pressure, self-esteem, don't get it from your friends, get it from yourself, and know who you are for you to be able to handle the outsider. Because the way you love yourself, that's how the outsider is going to love you. So feel free to ask me any questions. I have a 18-year-old, like I talked about, I'm old, but not wrinkled. I do have an 18-year-old, she just started college, and I have a 10-year-old, she's about to be 10 tomorrow, and she's here with me, and I brought her here. The reason why I made sure she's here, because it added to what we started. But I already told her, I'm bigger than that, so she can, you know, get to me.
Putting pressure on team to become what you want them to be, instead of what you want to be. From Africa, you come home and came around from that family of being a lawyer. So your parents want you to be a lawyer. Can everybody relate to that?
Yes.
So I want to ask what you here to talk about.
I don't feel like putting pressure on kids is the right thing to do. I think as parents, we need to have open dialogue. The critical piece is that that dialogue should have started when the child was a baby, not when the child is a teenager. So if you are able to communicate and have dialogue, then you guide your children. You don't pressure them. You let them exhibit and use their talents as they choose to.
Thank you. Pastor, can you, what do you think about that? Putting pressure on your kids to become what they don't want to be, what you want to be?
I think it's just much less what Dr. Mustafa said. From a psychological standpoint, you don't force the child to become what they want to be. Because already you are creating an atmosphere that they will not concentrate. From a pastoral standpoint, you likewise don't force them, but you try to guide them and nurture them in that direction. And where we have a problem today, like Pastor said, from that African standpoint, me not be doctor, so I want you, you for be doctor, me not be lawyer. It don't start when you get to that point. So like everybody else introduced themselves, I have two girls, and the thing about it, One of them already we started talking. My first daughter, who is 16, she just turned 16 this year, to go through, they dropped her and went to senior. She was supposed to go to 11th grade, they dropped her now. She knows what she wants to do. My second daughter, actually, we are just 14 months apart. We started off, at one point she said, oh, I'm going to be a lawyer. After a little while, he said, you know, Daddy, I want to be police. And then now she said, what I want to do? He said, I don't even know what I want to do. So she's yet to discover. But what I do, I guide them along the line, knowing that if you go to college without knowing what you're going to do, you will be hopping and hopping and hopping and wasting time. So you have to guide them at certain points. Right.
Thank you, Pastor. Can we just put our hands together? You know, those questions are very real. This is where we have the breakout in communication with our kids. It is very critical questions to deal with. And we want to really take those things into consideration. We have a person that can want to talk about that.
Yeah. All right, so I can speak based on my experience where my father actually pushed me to go into the field of computer science because he was a computer analyst. And I was very firm. I said no. And because I'm being vulnerable at this point to just open a share, my father actually withheld paying tuition for me. Because he wasn't going to pay tuition for something else other than computer science. And thank God that I chose to do what I wanted to do, even though I had to take student loans and pay for school, because I love what I do. I've never woken up in my professional life and you see people say, oh, it's Monday, I don't want to go to work. No, by Sunday night, I'm excited. I want to be at work for Monday because I love what I do. So as a parent now, I know my daughter and I, we've had these conversations probably since she was 3-4 years old. And each day it changes. One day I want to go into STEM, I want to be an engineer, the next day I want to be in the military, the next day I want to be an OBGYN, and it just changes. So as parents, like Dr. Suze said, our children have a plethora of options. And as parents, it's our responsibility to guide them, but don't force your views on them. Because ultimately, they have to live their best life. Not your life, not the life you want, but their life. Okay?
To the teens, is this question making sense? Are you getting something? Are we learning something? I'm quite sure those questions have been clear. Go back to something, and I must keep the conversation. I'll come back to you. There's something here that I can obviously relate to, and that is how parents don't realize that we have made a transition into a different culture. So when you talk to your kids, you are talking to them based on what you know. For example, in this culture, time is the basis of everything. Back in Africa, relationships is the basis for everything. If your kid tell you here, I got to go, it sounds very offensive. But that's the place where we live inside. And so when we communicate those things, it cracks our relationship. So I'm sure that you can start aside that not realizing that your kid has been raised in a different culture and environment, what would you say to that you experience with you?
Well, as far as parents, I think the biggest thing is that they like to compare, you know, their child to another parent's child, and I think that's like the biggest mistake. So, growing up in Washington, D.C. area back in the early 90s, everyone knew Ibrahim Kamara. Ibrahim Kamara was like a big brother in the community. Every parent wanted their child to be like Ibrahim because he was able to attain a scholarship to go to Syracuse. Not all of us were able to attain scholarships. But at the end of the day,
that does not make us any less of a student or people. So we parents need to stop comparing their kids to other kids. Focus on your child, see what's their traits, what are their qualities, what are they good at, and then try to capitalize on that. You know, they like to play piano, they like to read, they want to be a journalist, support them. Not everyone has to be an engineer like BJ was, you know, when he first started, but then as time went on, he decided to change and got involved in IT. So allow your kids to be themselves, do not compare a child to another child.
It's a totally different environment. Whereas in Maryland, a lot of places that we are in Maryland that we choose, especially with BCM Union, we they go outside drugs money, crime money, we know that problem, and we want for a little bit and secure, a good school environment, a good neighborhood, yes, a fine for raising king, and stuff like that. And I know you guys listen, you can hear what I'm saying, because we're not going to talk at the beginning now. So I know you understand fully well. So when I'm going back and forth, I know you understand the dialogue. So, but what I'm trying to say, the places that we take our kids to where we live, it's what we want our kids to become. Out of drugs, out of sex, out of violence, out of all that. You go to school where you have a safe counterpart. They can say, about the same fella as drugs together. So if you go to school, private school, with tension, training, of course, that's how it is. If you go to school that way, they can drunk and take drugs, of course, you will copy. And peer pressure. So I think that's what it is.
Thank you.
Can we ask questions before I
go? Yes, after this we'll get a couple of questions.
What she just said.
All right, okay. Okay.
I can go home in either way, but when I get to school, when my mother did not know I was the leader, not the follower. But then she thought I was the follower because I pretended at home. So we have to notice our child. When a child is too goody-goody, check. Yes. I'm being honest.
That's right.
When a child is being goody with you, check. I'm a victim. My mom, you can't tell me not say mix out our party. Look, do you say that? And pray for you. And find a gas to wear your life out. But guess what I was? I know how to play with my mom's intelligence. When the phone rings, I didn't go to school, I'm the first one to pick that phone up. Hello? Yeah? Yeah, listen to this guy, girl. I will pretend. But in that note, just to make this short, we have to notice our child's behavior. You guys, I don't care what neighborhood you carry your child to. If you don't teach your child what is self-esteem, how to love themselves, tell them that you love them every day, they're gonna follow that step regardless. I don't care. You can take them to the moon. They're gonna follow someone that is bad. But it's up to the kind of love that you give your child at home will make them respect you enough not to follow that, because they know your parent listen.
This question is going for principal, your just what she said, and I was listening carefully about our children that goes to school. Since you are principal, maybe you need to tell us how to handle it. Because I have grandchildren, and I have one that always they complain about me. But this boy always do these things, they say, while he's in class. When he's home, he's a totally different person. So I want to know, like, what's the last speaker said, you, the principal, and you deal with issues like this all the time. Like she said, she dressed up and go to the school. I used to be like that, thank God. Things have changed. I don't do that for my grandkids, but I did that for my children. And they never liked it, because they said, Mom, when you come to school like that, then I can't go back to school. But I don't want to do that for my grandkids. So I want to know, you that handle these issues every day, please tell us, what do we do? How do we handle this instead of going? going there all dressed up ready to fight. What do we do? And you as a principal, when some of these complaints come to you, how do you handle this?
As a parent, what I do every single year, the first day of school, I make it a point to take my child to school. The truth is, over the past few years, I haven't been able to because that's where my school opened, but I have a wonderful co-parent. Every co-parent are 12-year-old together. He drives and goes there, introduces himself to that homeroom teacher. Then, of course, it's teamwork. Then I start emailing the first day. I email all of my child's teachers. I introduce myself to them. I apologize I wasn't there today. But please feel free to contact me. I'm only a text away. I'm only an email away. That sets the tone. And between you and me, as some people then, the truth is sometimes when they see your name, they assume that you're uneducated, an immigrant, you don't know what to do, you're not going to fight for your child. When you reach out to them, you put them on notice that I'm an educated person and I am invested in my child and I will check in with you. So that's what I would suggest you do. Contact every teacher first day, first week of school. That means you put them on notice. The truth is, my school, the school where my child goes to, they know me so well that believe it or not, one morning my child was sick at school. I was on the way to work in Baltimore. The school called me to pick her up. I wasn't able to, so her father, who lives about a mile away from us, went to school. The principal picked up the phone to ask me a second time, can I release your child to this person? I said, of course, that's her biological father, her name is there. But because they know that I'm so invested, they had to double check and triple check to make sure, oh, it's okay. To the point that we were all chuckling about it, like, yes, his name is right there, Saifu Kumara, that's my child's dad. And yes, he's here to pick his child up. But as a principal, I have been in schools with large immigrant communities. And the truth is, the way they treat our immigrant children, it's difficult. I can't tell you how many kids I've had to put myself on the line for. And the reason for that is because I know where I come from. And I see what looks like just pure bullying. And sometimes as school leaders, we don't even think about it that way. So maybe a child who should be in an advanced placement class because they have an accent, you put them in an English as a second language class. Why? But it's very important for us as parents, again, to show up to these schools. I come home from work sometimes 8, 9 o'clock at night, I'm exhausted. But you know what, when my child's PTA meets one time a month, I drive and I show up there. And they know she is present, she is invested, okay? But as a school leader, when parents come to me with bullying issues, I have to just investigate, but also you need to know that we are constricted by what they call the student code of conduct. So for something where you are thinking, well, there should be a suspension, the student code of conduct says you can't suspend that child. So what we do at that is create the circles and make sure that there's some sort of restoration, okay? So there's some issues that I now know in the state of Maryland. I've always been in high school, I'm a high school principal, but for elementary school, the state says you cannot suspend a child from kindergarten through second grade. Believe it or not, students in second grade and kindergarten, herself, teachers, themselves, bring weapons to school and all that stuff. But the state says you cannot suspend them. So again, the best defense I would say would just be present, show up so everyone knows that you're here and you can't take advantage of my child.
I work at a college at Bowie State. The first thing I would say is to be very mindful and aware of your child's behavioral changes, whether it's in the
of whether you notice that they aren't speaking or aren't as present as they were before. Be very mindful and aware of your child. Yes, we say we know our children, but and we can always say we've been there, we've done that. And I mean, I'm only 29, I haven't experienced everything yet. I do know a lot, but there are new ways that they get around it. There are new codes for everything. So you yourself as a parent, you have to be up with the times. You need to learn the lingo. You need to learn what they're talking about. You need to learn the aspects of social media. I'm not saying that you necessarily hover over your children, but you have to hold yourself accountable. Yes, we can sugarcoat all of the answers that we give you today and tell you what you want to hear and what your children should hear, but at the same time, you also have to hold yourself accountable and do what you say you're going to do. My parents didn't necessarily hover over me. Of course, you have to instill different morals in your children, and then they know to be the way that they are supposed to be as well. But I will also say denial is a big thing. A lot of parents believe that their children isn't the one in the wrong, and at times your child is that person that is in the wrong. And yes, you defend your child, but you also communicate with your child when they are in the wrong. The other thing I would say is building a strong rapport and relationship with your children. Yes, we've said today, like telling your child, I love you, but are you actually doing it? And so that's what I think. Yes, we can't agree with you today, but when you do leave the summit today, make sure you're actually taking some of the tips and tools that we're giving you today and applying it in your household. It may be uncomfortable, because I know for myself, I don't use the word I love you to my parents. I don't think I've hurt my dad. We don't give hugs. So it's something simple, but it happens in our households every day. And then I will say on campus, they think I'm like their age, they're like 17, 18. I'm not too far from it. But because I've built that relationship and that rapport with some of the students, they're able to open up. So at home, they're not talking to their parents about their first menstrual cycle. At home, they're not talking to their parents about sex. At home, they're not talking to their parents about drugs and alcohol is a drug. But when they get to school, they are the first ones that need STI/STD testing. They are the first ones that need some of the consultation sessions that we do for tobacco cessation, because they can't stop smoking or they can't stop smoking cigarettes. So just be mindful and aware of your children and pay attention to your children.
One of the problems we're having is that when parents break up or they separate in our communities mostly, one person will be bad-mouthing the other parent, and that has led to a lot of animosity and things like that. As a clinical psychologist, what would you tell our parents, our community, about how they communicate to the children about the other parent when they are not together?
And I can speak to that because I was married for over 25 years, and at some point I became a single mother. And obviously we had, I would say four, because I had my nephew who was the fourth child, and we had to co-parent. Number one, try as best as you can to leave your children out of it. Your children were not there when you met, they were not there when you guys were going through your hassles, they didn't ask to come, so leave them out as much as you can in terms of the bad mouthing. On the flip side, encourage your children to engage with the other person. However, beyond that, what I want to say to the parents is this. As parents, going back to what my young lady said, we have to be proactive. I was working for the state, okay, and I'm not bragging. I was a manager for social services, child protective services. But when I broke up with my husband, I gave up my job for my children. When I went to court, I said, all I want my children and nothing more. And it's not because I had money, but because I realized my children are important to me. And so sometimes we have to make the determination. We have to make the sacrifice. So if you cannot come to back to school night, on a day that you're off, come to school. If you are not able, you're not computer literate, I just want to throw out information that is relevant. If you are not computer literate or you don't have access every day, when you go to the school, ask the teacher to send you a note once a week. On those days that you're off, first of all, before you're off, engage your children in participating in after-school activities. That keeps them busy. That keeps them engaged. When your kids have friends, your kids' friends becomes your friends. My children tell me I'm an FBI because I know their friends, I find time to talk to their friends, and I get to know their friends more than they do. The other thing too is when they're in after-school activities, be proactive. My kids were all in sports. I was working as a manager for child protective services. I was sometimes on call 7 days a week. Okay, so what I did was engage the other parents in the community. Sometimes they are coaches. If I have to pay them $25 to pick my child up, drop my child up, it's better than taking some time off from work. So in other words, what I'm saying, be creative, be engaged, be proactive, and you will not go wrong.
So I had to realize that my parents' relationship is different from, but like the relationship that my parents have is totally different from what I have with them. So I had to make sure that I was communicating with both parents, not trying to hold grudges against like one parent because one parent doesn't like the other parent. So I had to just do that for myself. So that's what I
from a clinical perspective, if we don't watch out in terms of our parenting style, our parenting skills, we traumatize our children. And we hold them back from progressing. You know, I don't know who the mighty love, but I'm also a victim of that. I came to this country when I was 17. You know, in the field, they still ask me, why is your accent so strong? Because I want to maintain my identity. So create an environment. That's my grandbaby. She's fine. There's nothing that I eat that she doesn't eat. First day of school, she was walking out the door. She said, Nina, we haven't paid. Because that's part of my culture. So when you start and you are able to be objective, it doesn't mean you give up what you know. But you embrace your environment and you respect your child's individuality.
I've been a pastor and also from the clinical psychology department. Our style of parenting, like Sister Zainab asked about co-parenting and Dr. said here, it got to take sometimes, the young lady just said something, that every child that becomes a victim, because divorce is terrible. Separation is terrible. And the innocent kids tend to suffer, especially if there is not a communication between the parents. And sometimes what happens, the kids know how to manipulate the parents. So due to that, they come in here to seek the parents. They want something from the dad. They know how to manipulate the dad. And the dad is trying to win them over to his side. And the same thing again go to the mother. And due to that, like Dr. Mustafa said, there are times in order to compensate because of that, the parents will allow them at times to have their way at the detriment of the children. Because we want to compensate, they are going through this, because they are going through this now, maybe we allow them to do things that on a normal basis, you will not allow it to happen. And because we want to compensate for that, we make that to happen. And then from the biblical standpoint, the Bible says, train up a child in the way it should go. And when it's old, it's not depart from it. No matter what happened, you put down the standard, not that rigidity, like I talked about the dotted lines, the thin line and the thick line. You got to know in between, when are they in the dotted lines? And try to let them know if you have gone beyond the dark line, you are in the thin line. And remember, you can't cross the thin line. Because if you go through the thick line, then things are going to be enforced. So we have to have that balance. And
all what the panelists have been saying here, I don't want to keep adding to it. But one thing that I do, like she said, creating a relationship. I have two daughters, but I tell you, if they go to their messes, it's me who call. Daddy, I know my message. Daddy, I'm feeling this clown. Daddy, I'm feeling this pain. I will take them, go with them, move around with them. It started with a relationship. Because even when I take them out for dinner, take them out, every Wednesday, it is their eat out. When we go, I open the door for them, I take the seat, and put the seat for them to sit. Mm-hmm. I say, yes, you know why I'm doing that? If any boy come around you, you cannot do this for you, eh?
Here. Nice to meet you, Doctor. Most of our kids were created separate. They're in the middle of a crossfire.
Yes.
So all the stray bullets from Ecomo and Brazil are hitting. Thank you, Doctor, for really playing that empathy. And Crystal.
I just want to add my voice as a parent. As a parent, you have to be a confidant to your children. One of my experiences I heard, when they were coming up as teenagers, you know, sister said there that, you know, we tend to believe our children from the standpoint of view of who they are in the home. But you can know your child when you are not there. That's the best time to know your child, when they are among their peers. And there has never ever been a time when which I have a call from school that they misbehaved. One of my boys, I was called upon at one time that he has friends that are not, you know, from the home he came from. So I tended to believe. I went to the school. But what I want to say here, from the point of view I want to come up with, be a confidant to your children. There was a time I was talking personally with them, and I found out something. But the way we go is that when you do something, we begin to make noise, we put on placards, that this is the thing that you did, this is what you did, this is what you did. If you do this, and do this. So I got wisdom that in talking one-on-one with them, I found out that in growing up as a teenager, there were some defaults in there. So what I did, I canceled them one by one. And they never heard it. The brother did not hear what the sister did. The sister did not hear what the brother did. And so, because of that, we are so much time together. They are my friends. Just before I came here, I'm here on summer holidays. So I've been talking to them today for almost 3 hours. I had individual discussion with them. When the sister came, mommy, what are you saying? I said, no, I'm not talking to you. I have personal time with them. And so they are I'm their confidant. They don't hear anything bad about one another. So let that be an advice to us parents.
Some people think they should not be their children's friends. But there is a friendship and there is friendship. You know, and we had this discussion, and some people say, oh no, you're picking up for being party. No, you're picking for being party. Because when you're picking being your party, it attends anything. It trusts you. You listen to her and it will tell you anything. But another question here, with somebody, one young person that we think says, why do African parents believe they are right about everything, but when we make suggestions, they say you are disrespectful?
So I think parents have to learn to open up. But I am saying that older people and adults should also have respect when speaking to their children as well. And the theme of it, of our program today is, are you listening? But are you listening to your children even after they've done? you said. Another thing that I can add on is with the dynamics of communication, especially amongst our culture, we have to understand healthy boundaries. So you can correct somebody or you can approach somebody with something, but the way you deliver is what's gonna make a difference.
Yeah.
So if, you know, as a child, as a parent, because apparently I'm both at this point, if you have a concern and you see that your parent may be, you know, upset in that moment or just not willing to listen to you, not necessarily hear you, because there's a difference between hearing and listening, but listen to you, walk away for a minute. What I try to tell my kids that I work with is, at the end of the day, your parents are human too, and they're human before their mom and dad. And I had to learn that when I became a parent. So sometimes it's hard to take advice when you're upset, and then from a kid. So you gotta be the adult in that moment and let them have their moment. And one thing that will never fail is we're good at it, is texting or writing, because they can't argue with that. So if you give them a minute, you text them, mom, you did this, this, and this, or mom, you know, this is what I meant when I said X, Y, and Z, they have to take it in. They have to let it digest for a minute, and then it provides a platform for healthy conversation. So
when your child does something, do not pick up the phone and start telling the story to your friend.
Yeah.
Avoid doing that. Because when the child listens, I become that person that you're talking about. Because regardless if I do good or bad, you already have a label on me. So the moment you have that label on me and I'm listening, hey, don't say it's sound today. That idiot, those words, idiot, stupid, take it out of your vocabulary. Unsnaming. Especially stupid. When a child is a smart child and you continue to say stupid, it sticks in their head. And when you want them to do something good, you don't get it from them at all. Because you already told them that they're stupid. One time, I think I used that one. Just eat, mommy, but you say I'm stupid, so wait till you are lying. And that got to me. And then the other one, I'm going to refer back to, some of us don't believe in therapy. I went to therapy with my oldest daughter. She was hitting, making sure that me and the dad was hitting heads together. Wait, can I tell you something? I don't pick up my phone, I chair. Where he called her in, I can do. Whatever she wants, I give it. Just to piss him off. Not because she needs it or she wants it. I do it because just to make him get upset. A white lady had to look both, all three of us, and told us that we're all stupid. The moment me and the dad started communicating, and we have a very good communication right now, we became a very good parent. Co-parents. Because as soon as my daughter does something, I just don't do all that, but the dad doesn't know. But the fact that he knows, we both on the same line, and she got the same punishment. So now she can't hide anything from us. Self-confidence, self-esteem, put it in your child. When she comes, like we went shopping, I don't know what she wanted. She said, oh, I want this, I got it. And then she saw somebody else having, oh, iPhone. Mommy, this one has iPhone. I say, is your name iPhone? Because that's what my mom used to tell me. Like, Baba, buy iPhone. But I told her, you said you want this specific phone and I got it for you. So now you have to appreciate what you chose, not what somebody else wants. So the moment you start teaching them that your choice should be your number one, not somebody else's, they will learn. So continue to say, my choice is at first, not somebody else's.
Yeah.
So please, please, let for pick your phone up and begin to tell what thing you begin on do. Because that party when you go tell, it became worst past what thing you give advice to the other one.
That's right.
So if we not go do that, I appreciate what she said. Each became different. You get for me, each one you party. This week I go sick to me, I'm not telling nobody, but I find a way to get that information out without her knowing that she told me. So we have to make our child our best friend and keep their secret to ourselves. Because the moment she shares it, that's it.
The question is, are the parent always right?
That's right.
So answer to that question, yes and no. Parents are sometimes right based on experience that we went through, that you see other people going through. All right, for my situation, Ms. Radiati was saying that you are a product of your environment. May be true, may not be true. I went to school, I went to elementary school in D.C. I went to middle school in D.C. and I got a scholarship to go to Syracuse University. Everybody's different. Every kid is different. What else between you and your kid is communication. You gotta be able to talk to your kid. Can't just listen to yourself. You gotta listen to your kid too. I have two, my daughter, I'm so surprised because the guy's supposed to be here. Most of the young kids, like teenage boys, they need this. They're the one that's supposed to be
here. Yes.
Right? My daughter, when she was going to college, my wife wanted to do nursing. And my daughter said, no, she wants to do psychology. She gave a reason why. And my wife gave a reason, said, nursing make more money. When you get out of school, you're going to find a job. She said, no, I don't like blood. I don't like this. This is what I want to do. And I told my wife, you got to listen to her. If this is what she want to do, fine. Let her go ahead and do it. She decided to go to psychology. She graduated, and she found out it was difficult for her to get a job. She's currently working with the government because I helped her get a government job as a financial analyst. So she's going back to school to do nursing. But she learned from her mistake, which is good. It's good for the kids to learn on their own. My boys, I have a 15-year-old boy, Abdul, who played basketball. When he was going to high school, he wanted to go to Flowers. And I told my wife, my daughter went to Flowers, but my son is not mature based on, I work with him. I know who he is. Those are my children. I know my daughter was more mature. She's not a follower, she's a leader. But my son is a follower. Most of his friends, he plays basketball. Most of his friends goes to Flowers. So I know that if he does go to Flowers, it's gonna be a problem. Because my schedule doesn't revolve around his schedule. Because the thing about it is all parents, your schedule gotta revolve around your kid's schedule. I figure out most people don't do that. My son used to play, both of my sons, they play football. And every time they go over there, the African parents never come by to pick up their children. You gotta take care of them, gotta invest in them. Work with them. Anything they want, you listen to them and have them advice. Listen to what they gotta say, then bring it up. Just like for me, I lead by what I do in the house. I can't tell my child to go wash dishes if I don't wash dishes in the house. I can't tell my son to go clean or go open the door for my wife if I don't do it for my wife. So whatever you do, the kids imitate you. They see what you do. So you gotta be mindful of everything you do in the house. You cuss in the house, the kid will listen, they will cuss, but they will do the same thing. So you have to be very mindful. And again, going back to your question, parents are right based on the experience. But it's all about blending. And how you blend stuff is communicate. Regardless of the status. Can be okay, I'm the dad, I'm the mom, whatever I say, no, it doesn't go like that. Sometimes the kids bring up some ideas and be like, wow, me and my wife are going through problems. And every time we talk to folks, they go out there and tell people, oh, this is what's going on. When our daughter was involved, the situation was solved. And we know that when my daughter was involved, that information is not going out like that. It stays in the house. So you'd be surprised, very surprised. My daughter is 22. Me and my wife were going through problems, like 3-4 months. Nobody can solve that problem. When my daughter came through and involved, that situation was solved within a day.
I'm going back to my 17, 18-year-old self to connect with what Cyril was saying. When I came to this country, I was a teenager, and I was doing very well in school to the point of making honor rolls. And then my uncle, who brought me, noticed that I was dating my boyfriend, who is now my husband. And he became so angry that the day, I brought my honor roll certificate, he blanked up. He said, I don't want to see it. Don't put it before me. I don't want to take a look at it. And I felt bad.
But the people that were living around, they were curious. They said, come here, we want to see it. We want to take a look at it. Yes, I made a mistake. I was 18 almost. Well, I was 18 already at that time, but I started dating my husband 2 months of my 18th birthday. And my uncle said, I don't want to see it. I don't want to see it at all. Take it away from me. I felt bad because I'm like, if I'm doing good at school, at least you can do this encouragement. So what I'm talking to parents and the parent, we should encourage our kids. They might make a mistake, but if we push them away, they will not continue in that mistake. The other thing is when she said, stop calling your friends and telling them the bad that your kid is making. A friend of mine came to me and we went to school. She said, my mom was calling everybody and telling her the mistakes that you were making. She said, I have to put a stop to my mom and said, mom, you don't know her. She's the one that teaches in school. She's the one that shows us things in school. We're not smart like her. So if she made a mistake, it does not have anything to do with her academics. So I made the mistake that because I didn't have people to guide me and I didn't know this country much, so I thought I have to quit school. But thank God my teachers told me, no, go for your high school diploma, get it. And I went for it and my teacher was so proud of me. He pushed me throughout and I finished and I passed my high school diploma, I got my certificate. To this day, now I can say I am the proudest of my uncle. He goes everywhere telling them that what I thought she was going to be is not what she is. Despite the mistake, mistakes are going to come, but you lead them in the right direction, they're going to have the confidence to go further and do better.
When we give back to the children, they grow so well. You tell them how close to wear, they listen to you. You tell them what they need to do in the house, they listen to you. But once they get to that teenage years, just like, I think that person was supposed to be the speaker said, when they try to find themselves, that is where we start to butt heads. And for us that are not born here, we were brought up in a way that is different from this country. It is so difficult and challenging to tackle that period. And I think we need some kind of education in that. Because sometimes it's not the way what the kids are saying, but what the way they're saying it to us, you know, make us have some type of offense, like it's too offensive, don't talk to me like that, and our own fight will start. And I think that is something that we need to learn, even during the walk of life, because some of us have positions in healthcare, we see this every day, like you are in charge, and you, as that young 20-year-old, you're talking to them, don't talk to me like that, you tell them to do this and they give you that thing. So, but to them, it's a normal thing. But to us, we feel offensive. And that's where the relationship are breaking. So if you can just respond to that, when they get to that stage, as parents, what do we need to do in order for us to start parenting the right way and don't lose them? Because at that time, we can totally lose them.
Thank you. That's a very legitimate question. I have both people on my side want to say something, so I'm going to let them speak and then I'll go to this. Is that okay?
That's fine. So I can give you insight from the perspective of the child. Like you said, first of all, when you have us in this country, it's something that you have to keep in mind. The same way you feel like you're battling against a culture, we're battling against two cultures. Because we don't belong to the Americans, as well we don't belong to the Africans. So we're not placed. And we end up mixing up the two cultures. So I think, like, for example, it's been places where I go and I look people in the eye when I'm
speaking to them. And I'm thinking it's because I'm confident and what I'm telling you is true. But I've had people take offense to it and say that I'm being disrespectful. I called my dad silly one time and he wanted to beat the life out of me. I didn't think it was offensive. I thought we were joking and my dad is silly. But he thought it was a complete, like the worst offensive thing I could say to him. So sometimes the way you take things is not necessarily the way we're putting it off. It's the fact that coming between two cultures can be extreme, coming up between two cultures can be extremely, not only challenging, but confusing at times. So before you're quick to take offense, if I call you silly, tell me, you know, this is not acceptable. Or if you were gonna say this, make sure you don't say it in this way or this way because it's gonna be taken X, Y, and Z. So that's just something to keep in the back of your mind from the perspective of the youth.
My daughter, when she was 8, I told my daughter what I went through with my mother. I was a very troubled teenager. And while I was doing that, my mother never knew that I was being sexually molested. And I was acting out negative attention. And the teenage years is the calm and storm period. Sometimes you're good, sometimes you're bad. You're struggling with your identity. And I remember I was a rough parent. And I beat my daughter for a little something she said. And she looked at me, and I could remember. She said, "Mommy, you're becoming your mother." Since then, I went to Korea. I was in the army. I came back, my daughter had become a teenager. And we had to go to counseling because I was losing my child. I went to counseling with her. They taught me some new ways and I started doing it. And I remember one time she said, they said, "You gotta give her privacy." I'm like, "What is privacy? I don't know privacy." And so one day I knocked on the door. And she said, "Yes, who's it?" I said, "It's me." And I opened the door. She said, "Oh, I didn't tell you to come in." I said, "Don't push it. I'm just trying here." And since then, me and my daughter, she's 27 now, beautiful girl. I don't have no behavioral problem with her because I understood and I did not become my mother. And because some of us, we become our parents. And unconsciously, we don't know that. And we try to be that authoritarian parent over our children. And the teenage years are very troubling times. And we forget that we were teenagers once upon a time. And we went through the same thing. That's all I want to say.
Deliver, lay a foundation. The concept, first concept is balance. You need to have a balance, like we're talking between the two cultures right now. Culture in Africa, culture in America. For us, like you say, we can be 27 years old, 28, 29, 30 years. We still take direction from our parents. So here, they are longing to become 18. So they make their own decision. But you that have been brought up in Africa, you look at, what is that 18-year-old picking up or can tell me? But we got to understand that this is how the culture is being put in place. So the first thing is to understand it. When I teach my youth at the church, one of the things I said to them, the only way you can relate to them is to go into their world, understand their world, so that you can bring them out of their world into your own world. You first of all got to go into their world. You got to learn their talks, like he said, speak their language. Yeah. They talk silly. My daughter, sometimes they will tell me some stuff. 2 days ago, she does, there are some words I pronounce. She said, "Daddy, not know well to pronounce it." I said, "Well, that's fine." So you learn it from these accents. You talking about accent. I said, "You people have accent too. Come to Africa, you have an accent." So I dip into their world. So I was going for a meeting because she does this, I call it bomb or palm or something like that, where they dance like something like cheerleading, the other one. So, right? So I was on my way there and going to pick her elder sister. That's the younger one. You know what she started to think? She said to me, she said, "Daddy, are you wearing Africana?" I said, "Why are you asking?" He said, "Since you are going home, if you are wearing Africana, please change your Africana." Because all the other boys, he said, it's a general meeting where that way. I present you like you are one of us here. Because each time I dress up, when I don't wear Afrikaner, you will see her come with her phone like this. Sometimes I try to understand what are they doing. You will have the phone, take it from down, up. Not where it is out there. So you really have to understand their world. If not, we'll be going out of the way. Because this is their culture. And they are born into this culture. You can enforce that African culture, then 30 years they will still be under Mama Tekima. Yeah. But here, 18 years, they can make decisions on their own.
Very well said. Additionally, what I was going to say is there is no manual on parenting that is perfect. Okay? Look at your child, look at your child's personality, look at the environment, and then ask yourself, what is it I want for my child? Okay, counseling works, therapy works. Beyond that, think outside of the box. Allow yourself to be you in the sense that sometimes go back and think, what did I go through? And I say that a lot to parents. In Sierra Leone, you know, a lot of times we begin to freak out when our children are 15, 16, 17 and they start liking boys. These days I remind them, do you want them to like boys or do you want them to be homosexual? So if they like it, boys, thank God, that's number one. Number two, they need practice. A lot of us have difficulties in our relationships because we have no practice. A lot of what went on in Sierra Leone worked because the environment was conducive. Here, it's not conducive. That doesn't mean, as I said earlier, you abandon what you already know. But allow yourself to explore. As a parent, talk to other parents. As a parent, talk to your child. As a parent, take initiative. Read books. When they tell you to go to counseling, it works. Okay? What you need to find, like everything else, like your doctor, find somebody that is seasoned and somebody that is culturally relevant. If they are culturally relevant, they're going to lead you the right direction. Same thing with parenting and everything else. Another thing we have to remember, our parents were not monsters. The mentality. Our parents were raised by ex-slave masters. So therefore, that authoritarianism was passed down. And that was all they knew. And so in our subconscious, we are doing the same thing. We need to break the cycle. When we pray about generational curses, we need to break it. That's part of generational curse because it's not good. So think about those things. Think about what you say every day, even when you pray. And I'm using because we pray so bad. Oh, Papa God, wake up, this. Think about it, stop. You know, my children, they can come to me, okay? And they say, Mom, I don't want you to say anything. I just want you to listen. And they go on and on and on. There's, as Dalima said, there's a difference between listening, hearing, and having conversation. When they come and they tell me, Mom, I just want you to listen, I do that. Before I would tell them, what's the use? Why they can't talk to me if you don't allow I talk? But then, gradually, because every time they talk to me, I stop and I think. Create an environment where they have reason to want to do well, to want to succeed. As our pastor said, when I was raising my kids, every week, Saturday, Sunday, I cook and I put in the fridge. We eat African food. So that's why they all can eat pepper food. But on Fridays, if you have a good week, Fridays eat. Either they get pizza, we go out to eat, or whatever. So it's not just telling them, it's living it. You have to create the environment where they can emulate and they can come back. That's why my children can come. My daughter is in Africa right now. Every single day, even Dalima, we live in the same house. Every single day we text. We find time to sit down and talk. It doesn't mean I tell them everything about my personal life. There are boundaries. You have to set boundaries, you have to limit. But they know that when they want to talk, Mom can listen.
We have Dr. Alima here. But what I would say is, all right, so I'm a teacher at heart, and if there's noise, I can't really speak. All right. Okay, so let's just settle down. This is the reason why it's really important for us to build authentic relationships with our children. I went to
workshop a few months ago, and they were talking about trauma, okay? And trauma is a very loaded term. For someone like me, I grew up in Sierra Leone during the war. I came here when I was 17. So some of the things that are with me, I don't necessarily think of as trauma. But I'm sure those things come out in my parenting skills. So I took a survey at one of these events, and it's called an ACE survey. I don't know if you know the Adverse Childhood Experiences Survey. And I always consider myself as the best parent I know. And I gave it to my child, and I was shocked that she burst out crying right there. Why are you crying? Because, mommy, I don't think you don't love me, and you love my cousins better. And I was shocked. For her to always have the best. And here you are, I take you on vacations every year, we go to different countries and places, and you're telling me I'm a bad mother?
Yes.
So why? And then I sat down with her and started to listen to her. Some of the things she took offense to were just as simple as me telling my nieces and nephews, oh, I love you more. And she took it to heart. And for her, in her brain, it meant I didn't love her as much as I love my nieces and nephews. Which of course is not true. So sometimes when we don't have the avenues, I'm sure you all have heard the story about the professor who was killed by the son of Bowie. Sometimes our children are troubled. That's the truth. Some of them are dealing with disabilities that are undiagnosed. Some of them are dealing with diagnosed disabilities, but in our culture, una wicha no wicha. Instead of taking your child to an expert, to a clinician, and then when the tables turn, they kill you, and in some cases, you don't even live to tell the story because you're gone. Yeah. So that's why it's important, A, to love our children, set boundaries with our children, because even though they are our are still their parents. That's our responsibility, right? But more importantly, know our children well enough when we need to take them to see the clinician, you don't have to tell anyone your business. The fact that you're taking your child to a psychologist does not mean you're crazy or they're crazy. We have to move away from that stigma in our community. And it's not just our community, black people in general. Just because you have to see a clinician does not mean that you are a poor parent. And sometimes it's as simple as bringing in someone from the outside so they can give you a different view, a different look. And some of the things I've heard here today, I feel really blessed, honestly, because when I started, I told you all I'm not a child expert. I'm a parent, and I'm still learning, okay? And so I can go back and some of the things I've heard to do it with my child. And hopefully, since she's going through that preteen era, I will not be able, or she won't be able to fall into some of those pits and mistakes that some of you as parents have made, okay? So, but I would say going back to Auntie Zainab, just making sure that we know our children and we're making sure that we connect them with our resources within our communities so we are not here. Saloon folks don't kill each other, let alone a child killing a parent. So we need to do better by our children, listen to them. We're working too much because we want to drive a Range Rover, get a big house, and then that's true, but at the end of the day, what is it going to matter if your child and you don't have that good relationship? How are you going to enjoy it? How are you going to have those grandbabies coming around when you retire for them to enjoy this house and the vehicle with you? So let's think about it comprehensively, but I would say go see a clinician, a social worker, psychologist,
child's life.
We all don't talk something where we help we follow we protect we self from the beginning and everything. But like everybody has said, listen to your child, understanding your child and everything. But at the same time, what we're afraid of is to tell our family member that our child have a problem. So what we do, we avoid the whole situation, act like it doesn't exist. So when we act like it doesn't exist, our child develops more into that violence and that rage, into drugs, sex, violence, killing, you know, all those kind of stuff. So when you realize that your child is acting up in a sense that you don't know or somebody give you a hint, do not yell at your child. Observe. Take notes. Then you say, you know what, let's go see a therapy. Like I tell people, therapy do works. You might not think it works for white people, that's a lie. It works for me. Right now, me and my daughter, we're like, she will call me for everything. Mom, guess what? This boy likes me. And I try to be him. Like, I don't know who said that, trying to be your friend, I mean, my daughter's friend. When I said, what's up, y'all? You know, we're going to the party. Mom, stop. But guess what? I'm having fun, I'm connecting with them. She thinks I'm just a mom. So when we start connecting with our kids, understanding them, and one thing I've learned is to say sorry when you're wrong. When I'm wrong, like one time I chew gum and I put it on the cup. So she had gum. So I thought that she put it in there. And she came and said, oh mom, I still have mine, it was yours. And I said, oops, I'm sorry. You guys can ask her. I always say I'm sorry when I'm wrong. So once we start doing that, we'll be good.
We all want what's the best for our kids, but how can we get to that if we don't give them the support? So if you have kids blessed with talent, we don't have all engineers, all lawyers, whatever. Whatever talent they have, you gotta work with them and make them fulfill their goals. Second thing I have is communication. We have to be able to learn to listen to our kids. And we have to tell them the pros and cons. And let them be able to make decisions out of it. What we're here for is to guide and protect them. If we see they're going wrong, we have to let them know. The other thing is like, just like they were saying, is some call school max. I'm always on school max, checking on my kids' grades. You have to be on top of that every day, checking your kids' grades, and see exactly how they progress, how they doing in school. If you do that, 9 out of 10, your child will be successful.
The theme of this summit is, are we listening? We have to listen to the kids. Most of the time we think that we are always right. The kids are always wrong. But sometimes the kids are right. Like the other day my son told me, well mom, why is it only me that is doing the dishes? And guess who is there? Myself and daddy and the twins and the 4-year-old. So who else should do the dishes? Me and daddy? I don't know, I'm just saying. So, yes, I have to do the dishes sometimes too. So, they are not wrong when they tell us things that we really need to do. So, we need to listen to the kids, and kids, you need to listen to us also.
Are we listening?
Yes.
Are we really, really, really listening?
Yes.
So that's the theme, right?
Yes.
So we've got all of this, we've got this dialogue, we've got all this discussion. So to address that issue on the societal, we need to have a time to talk. Sometimes talk therapy can save us from depression.
Yes.
Something suicidal is built out of depression and anxiety. So if we allow a dialogue with the kids, and also we got to remember that when we give the phones to the children, we've given them the whole world.
Yes.
In that phone, the whole world is in there. They learn what to do there. They can decide on things and plan and all the stuff. To avoid this suicidal thing that is happening in our community, it's not something we can address all the way within this limited time we have. But when we create the forum, we can have dialogue and go in there. But to start with, we need to engage the kids. I talked about the cry of the African baby. They sometimes think that we don't listen to them. We don't give them the audience. So as parents, let's create an atmosphere
The atmosphere you create determines the air you breathe. When the atmosphere is pleasant, it will allow a dialogue to continue. In the multitude of counseling, the Bible says there is safety. Yeah. So let's create that opportunity and we'll help to eradicate those depressions.
Okay. What I want to say is that we have to begin to cultivate a new mindset. We have to get out of the mindset of ego disgrace me, I go shame, I for keep a secret. We need to get out of the cocoon and ask questions. We need to seek resources. As much as we are listening, if we're not doing anything, then it's a mute point. If we need to be able to observe our children, observe their behaviors and act. Don't say, oh, she's just being petty. Oh, he's just, you know, seeking attention. Different folks, different strokes. Okay? For us adults, we need to get out of the stage of denial. Starting with self-medicating. When I say self-medicating, not necessarily taking medication. I don't go do double, I take one glass of wine. I take two Benadryl. And you haven't even checked on your children. And your children are busy. So we need to begin to cultivate a different mindset where we are proactive, as I said before, ask questions. The media is fantastic in the sense, if you don't want people to know your business, first of all, you can Google almost anything. You can get answers. The school, the recs, go to your pastor. If you don't want to ask your pastor that's from Sierra Leone, go to another pastor. There are many resources. You know, online counseling, if you don't have time to go to a counselor's office, there are resources. Utilize the resources, talk to your children, get to know your children, get to appreciate their experiences. As Dalima said, they are living in a diverse multicultural environment. And so a lot of times we realize what they're experiencing in the school system. And a lot of things start in the school. As much as we also have to watch the home environment, we have to understand and appreciate what they're going through. Being an immigrant, being a foreigner, is no longer a joke. Okay, and so for things that we might think are not important, for example, how your child dresses to school, you know, a big one is what they smell like. Because we wash them every day doesn't mean they smell right. And I bring that up because it's a very, very critical point. We cook fish, then plasas them, then ogiri them, then begin and close the smell. And when they go to school, then they tease them. We know not about that. And they afraid for God tell them because they know how to go sense confusion. But if you are in communication, if you are monitoring your child, you find out that when they go to school, they're not comfortable. And because they're not comfortable, they don't want to go to school. They begin to do things that are not germane or things that, you know, you don't appreciate. When they are stressed, they talk to their friends. When they are stressed, like you are doing, drinking that glass of wine or taking that Benadryl, they start experimenting with drugs. They start experimenting with sex. Being in denial that she's 16, hormones, you know, is they are, exactly. Okay, and the school system, whether you know it, I was just talking to a parent on Thursday evening, the child is 16, and she was telling me, Auntie Alima, you know, this picky, the way they dress, the way they don't begin, I think they don't begin like boys. I say, stop. When you be 16 in a salon, when they not be shown on TV, you not be begin like boys. Okay, and I say that not to make her feel bad, but to face the reality. Then I went further to tell her. I said, do you know that in the school system, most high schools have clinics? Okay, most high schools give out condoms. Do you know that? And they don't have to get your permission. She was like, what? I said, they don't even have to ask the social worker. It's on the table, on the desk of the social worker. They can just walk in and grab it. And tell him, are you serious? You wanted to see her face. But if you're not engaging, you're in denial because she's in your house, you are making a sad mistake. So again, be proactive, be engaged, and don't be in denial. Ask questions, seek resources, seek out information, and utilize them.
We talked about listening. Listening, you can just, I'll sit here and BK will say something, but am I actually listening to BK? The word, there's two words. Active listening. You have to make sure when you're talking to your kids
You are sitting there, eye to eye contact, and listening to your kids. Actively listening to your kids. Because this is what we do at work. We sit there and talk to our patients. So, and geared towards Vicky said before, in regards to the word mistake. I don't use that word at my house. I use the phrase, room for improvement. With everything that we do, there is room for improvement. I use that at work, I use that with my kids. We have room for improvement. My daughter too graduated recently. You know, you went to the cookout. So she majored in psychology. But what did I do? I'm a nurse. I wanted her to be a nurse. I wanted her to come work for me at my job, but she chose psychology and I supported her. I supported everything that she does and she has done so far. Is it a mistake? Of course not. Does she want to do something else? Of course, yes. But that's her choice. And I'm so happy and I'm so elated that she graduated from college. We should be happy and we should celebrate our kids because we have so many civilians, so many kids that have not graduated. They have kids. That's not a mistake. A child is not a mistake. Like I said, we're not using that word. That's what they choose to do. But let's celebrate our kids. Whether you majored in psychology or sociology, it's your choice and we are happy for them. And another thing, one more thing before I leave this place. This, I think, is a culture thing. Because we don't say the phrase, I love you. We don't say I love you enough to our kids. I know, not just because my mom and dad don't say I love you to me when I was in Sierra Leone, doesn't mean that they don't love me. Of course they love me, and I know they love me. But this is a different culture. This is a different society. This is a different climate. So if we can take one thing away from this summit, let's start to say, I love you. When you wake up in the morning, say I love you, not just I love you. I love you. Say I love you like you meant that. You mean what you say. Please, parents, our kids need that phrase. I love you, and I love both of my kids.
But I want to thank you both for quite a brilliant idea from Sister Zaina. Lord, we pray that people will come around this idea so that we can impact our community for the better. Lord, we pray for everyone that has contributed to this program today and some of them have spent their family here. Lord, we pray that you remember their efforts and bless their life as well, Lord. And we pray for the teenagers too. And now they go to school, what our discussion today, Lord, we ask that these kids will be good kids, Lord. The insight and wisdom will speak into their hearts and the deeper we can understand. As we go back to our previous location, Lord, take us safely. And we also thank you for Sister Gabriel to be the best. And we just thank you all for us around as well.